Welcome, thank you for coming here. My name is Abdullahi Egal, and this is Algin Maduro. We are both developers at InfoSport, hired by Twyp. I was the operations guy and the backend developer. I did a bit of backend with Twyp. Algin was a backend developer, and he did a little bit of operations, so we worked a lot together to make this possible. So what do we want to say in the coming 45 minutes? First, we want to give you a short introduction about what is Twyp, because yeah, you've heard it a lot today. We're gonna see what it is. Second, before we can explain what Kubernetes is, it's good to go to a history. Why did we use Kubernetes? Why did we start with it? What was our reasons? Then we'll give an overview of Kubernetes. Then perhaps some other technologies that derived from Kubernetes that we used. And finally, a wrap up. So. Instead of just explaining what Twyp is, because that's boring, I'd rather show you guys a video of it. I do have to warn you, the video is in Dutch.
Not real.
Leuk toch, uit eten met vrienden? Als je terugbetalen tenminste. Met Twyp is dat zo opgelost. Je maakt met de app supersnel geld over naar een vriend uit je contactenlijst. Het is net zo eenvoudig als chatten. En bij welke bank je zit, maakt ons niet uit. Je vrienden betaal je nu nog makkelijker met Twyp. Download nu de app.
So Twyp is a peer-to-peer payment application, so where you can pay your friends in an easy way. Because usually if you want to pay people, you need to know their IBAN. And who knows his own IBAN, for example. So I'm not the only guy that's... okay, cool. Yeah, it's not easy to know your IBAN. Guess how hard it is to know someone else's IBAN. So instead of knowing the IBAN, all you need to know is the phone number of that person. And that phone number is stored in your address book of your phone. So you just have to install it, enter your phone number, and you can use it. So it looks like this. You register, you pay, you chat. You can do all kinds of things. If you haven't installed it, go ahead and try it. It's cool. But that's not what we want to talk about. What we want to talk about is how we used Kubernetes with Twyp. Why did we use those technologies, and what did we learn from using Twyp and Kubernetes in production? So, for example, Kubernetes or Twyp. Twyp is a startup company from the ING. ING has a new way of working. If they have a new ID, they'll create a startup within that company, and that startup has a lot of freedom and is not really titled by the rules of the company. So you do have to listen to the procedures of the big boss, but other than that, you're quite free. And the team consists of 10 engineers, front-end, back-end, Android, iOS, all of them. A little bit multidisciplinary, so I'm operations guy. I did a lot with Kubernetes, but I also developed in the back-end. We got the operations, that's me. Some business guys, a few designers to create this design, and a tester. So it's quite a small team that's actually independent organization, independent company within the bigger ING. So, like I said, we used Kubernetes with Twyp. But in order to understand that, we need to know what was the history. Why did we decide to use Kubernetes with Twyp? And the project started in January 2015. And then it was a startup with all of these and no product. So we were quite free on how to develop it or how to build it. And we knew that this could be a big project that could become popular. We already have 250,000 of people that are using it. So we wanted a project that could scale and that could change and scale according to the needs of the customers. Because this project would go to multiple countries and would be deployed to multiple places. So we had to think like that. And we started with deploying our application in microservices. So within a few months, we already had a dozen of microservices. So we had to adapt very quickly. And in the beginning, we just used Docker. We had a whole environment scripted with Docker, We had a dev environment with Docker. We had a test semi-production back then with Docker. And Docker worked just fine if you just work on one environment. In one machine, Docker is very easy. Docker run and you have like 10 services on one machine. But it gets harder if you run Docker on multiple machines or if you want to run Docker on a distributed environment. Because Docker runs well on one machine if you use linking or volumes or things like that. But it gets harder because you cannot use linking on multiple machines. If you cannot use linking if you want to link with a Docker container on a different machine. Even volumes get harder because volumes only live on one machine. And there are ways to solve that. For example, in the beginning we wanted service discovery, we wanted Docker containers to find each other, and therefore we used the tool console. And it fit its needs, but it only solved one issue, and we had multiple issues, because deploying is quite hard. How you're going to decide on which machine you want to deploy? So we all had those problems, and the issue was we already had 20 plus microservices. All Docker containers that had to run somewhere. And yeah, so we needed a few things. We needed discovery, we needed monitoring, because we needed to know, okay, where are those microservices? And even on one machine that became a bit hard. We needed to scale, because on one machine, a Docker container runs a port 8080, but if you want to scale it, it has to run on a different port, because you cannot have two ports on one machine. Especially if you want to expose them or access them in one way. So we had some issues. And then this came, Project Atomic. For some reason we stumbled upon this project. It was in May 2015, so I don't remember exactly how we went there. But in some way we stumbled upon Project Atomic. And Project Atomic is an open source Red Hat product, which is based on Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And one of the good reasons why we could use this is because we had system administrators and operation people that already worked on Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And they already had a contract with Red Hat. And Red Hat Atomic Host is run on Docker. It's a minimum OS. It has one text editor, no package manager, and only Docker installed. The only usable thing that you can do on that is Docker and a few other things. And it has Kubernetes support as first-class citizen. So for a small company to use Kubernetes in production with support from Red Hat, that felt amazing. So we decided to use Project Atomic. And so Project Atomic has Kubernetes as first-class citizen. But the moment we started with Kubernetes, it was quite early. Like, not even version 1.0 was available. Not even the version before 0.21, but we started with 0.9. So the first time we worked with Kubernetes was version 0.9. That was like super alpha, hardly any beta product at that moment. And luckily, the moment we went to production, Kubernetes 1.0 got released a few days before. So yeah, we took a risk, but you can take that risk as a startup. Well, not really, but as long as version 1.0 is out and it's production ready, it was safe. But back then, we worked with the oldest API. We had to make choices based on the previous versions. Right now, we just migrated to 1.2. Because Red Hat Atomic Host is actually using Kubernetes, but it's using an older version of Kubernetes, then patches a lot of security holes, and then patches the Kubernetes version and secures it a bit with SA Linux and stuff like that, and then it releases it. So we're always a little bit behind on the current version. Right now we have a version that was from, do you know?
October 2015.
Okay. Yeah, but it's secured. Algin is going to tell you more about how we used Kubernetes and the challenges we faced, but that's about Kubernetes. And with Kubernetes, we used a lot of tools. Here's an overview of the tools we had. Some are with Kubernetes, some are without. Because this gave us the possibility to, for example, work with the Java service and then see like, hey, wait a minute, I can do this better in Node.js. Give me 2 days or a week. So we rewritten some services in a week to another language like Node.js, and it gave us that freedom. We even have a PHP service somewhere running, and lots of other technologies. But even though these are not all technologies that run in Docker, some are, like Elasticsearch, it gave us the freedom to do that. And we actually scripted our Kubernetes environment. And one thing we do different than was told in the previous presentation about Red Hat. What is it? Red Hat Origin?
OpenShift
Origin, yeah. One thing we do different is we solve the deployment parts in our build environment. So we have Bamboo as our build environment, which is, yeah, who knows what Bamboo is, by the way? It's not enough, so I have to explain it. Bamboo is like a continuous delivery, continuous integration tool, similar to Jenkins, similar to go.cd. I see some people understanding it right now. Cool. And with that, you can build your project and deploy your project and script it. And we actually use Docker. We actually first compiled our code. So our build steps look like this. We first compile and scan our code. Then we do all kinds of tests, unit tests, integration tests, performance tests. Even, not in our build, but we have resilience tests where we break half of a cluster down and see if everything keeps running. And then we build and push the Docker container. And after that, we can deploy to desk, test, dev, acceptance, production. We have a DTAP environment, and we will keep it that way, even though it's more popular to have one production environment and you put everything on it and disable some things. But we use Bamboo to deploy to Kubernetes, and we have customized shell scripts to do that, because back then there were no deploy tools. Just in Kubernetes 1.1, the first deployment tools became available to do it. So we just had to upload pods and do rolling updates with replication controllers. By the way, before I'm going to make things too technical, who knows what Kubernetes, who has experience with Kubernetes? And for the ones that don't have experience with Kubernetes, do you know what it is or how it works? Yes?
Yeah.
I see some. Okay. Well, then it's a good place you're here because you can learn it here. I blurred it a little bit, sorry. We as Twyp had to eventually follow the procedures of a big company like the ING. The reason why is because we are working with money. We are working with transaction data. We are working with personal information. And as a big company as ING, you cannot just make that data accessible to every employee. So there were rules. And even though Kubernetes is made to like make sure everyone can reach kubectl that's required to, we had rules that it wasn't allowed to everyone. So we had to make custom dashboards. And this is one of those dashboards we have on the wall. It's a wall board which shows the status of our Kubernetes pods in our environment. And one thing we did was create as many dashboards possible to actually be able to, well, not as many as possible, but the necessary ones, so you could work with Kubernetes without having root access. And this one shows the errors on the top side, the machines that are deployed. It shows, this is just a basic overview, so if we see anything red here, we immediately come in action, unless it's the test environment. But. So next up, Algin, my colleague, will show you the concepts that form the foundation of Twyp.
So basically, we started with Twyp. He told you a little bit of how we started and why and all these kind of things. So basically, our building blocks, we started with Docker, and then we wanted to go wider, and clustering, and Kubernetes came into place. And so it was not really a steep learning curve, but at that moment, Kubernetes was version 0.9, so we had limited capabilities within Kubernetes itself. So we had to do what we could with what tools were available. But one of the requirements, we as developers said that we want to build a highly available, resilient, and responsive platform that can be scalable technically and operationally. So what Kubernetes did was realize highly available, and responsive. And the resilient part we had to make ourselves, kind of. Because of the microservice architecture, you get dependent on a couple of other services, but we try to mitigate that as much as possible by using message queuing in between. So, how Twyp, uses Kubernetes, yeah. Like I mentioned, we had limited capabilities of Kubernetes. Right now it's a lot richer and you have a lot more features than we had to work with, so. I will just give the basics. So Kubernetes is, I hope you all know the definition of a pod or application controller. Services, volumes, probes, and secrets. I will go into a quick overview of what they are and possibly give our tips and tricks on how we had to overcome certain challenges we had within these different areas. I have a small question to you all, though. You guys know why Kubernetes called it a pod? Anyone know the reason?
No.
No? Okay, basically, as you can see, the Docker logo is a whale. And one whale is a whale. And two or more whales is a pod of whales. So they smoothly integrated the pods. So basically, as you can see, a pod consists of one or more Docker containers. But so basically it becomes a pod if it's has more than one. A pod is also the smallest deployable unit within Kubernetes. So basically, if you have one Docker container in a pod, then you can deploy that. But you cannot deploy Docker containers on their own. And containers can reach each other, so through localhost, so you have less network ops. So grouping things where necessary is a smart idea, but you don't have to always group everything just so you can have everything talk to each other through localhost. For example, what in OpenShift origin, he mentioned that you don't want to keep your database with your WordPress, because if you upgrade one, then both of them go out. So that is then a trade-off you have to make when designing your thing. A replication controller, as you all might know, is just basically the manager of a pod, of the pod. So basically, you can just say, I want two, your desired count is two, but let's say due to limitations or you don't have any space left or anything, then it will try to do what it can. It will try to do its best to schedule a pod. But if it doesn't have any resources or anything left to schedule it, it will keep on trying until more resources become available, basically. One thing to mention that we had problems with at Twyp is that, I will go two slides further, is that we have a multiple data center solution. So for geolocation, or for if one of them burns down to the ground, and then you have a backup, a disaster recovery plan, basically. And one of the problems we faced is that to get a replication controller to replicate over the data centers, we had to give it the amount of nodes on one data center plus one. So basically, in this case, we have three machines on data center one and three machines on data center two. To be sure that there would be at least one instance in data center one and one instance in data center two, we had to replicate it three times, so it fills one data center for sure, and then a fourth times for it to have a pod on the other environment. And what we then did is we found this small clever solution, but it's probably what it was meant for, is to have node selectors on the replication controller. So basically, you tell we labeled each node. We labeled it. You belong to data center one. You belong to data center two. And the other ones we labeled. You belong to data center two. And basically, what we did is to create two replication controllers. So the one manages data center one. So it has a node selector saying, "I want you to schedule all your pods on the first data center and the second replication controller, we say we want you to manage the replication on the second data center. So this was our solution to having a multi-data center, either geo-localized. Yes, question.
You created this one service on top of those two replication controllers?
So basically, you can see two data centers, but they are interconnected through etcd and FANUC. So the networks are, so basically you can see both data centers as one Kubernetes cluster. It's just split into different locations between two. I don't know if that answers your question.
Now, what I wanted to know is if there's one service virtual IP, that will go to all the ports and all the data centers.
Yeah.
Sometimes it is. Sometimes for some things we have one service for one data center, one for one other data center, and we do that through labeling. So one service only routes to one data center, one to the other. But because the latency between the data centers is not that much, we don't do it for most of the services.
So this is also one of the ways we can guarantee active-active. So if you have two different exposure IPs or anything, then you would have to tell your front end or whatever, or the F5, that you have two, you have to route to two places instead of to route to one, since we do have this big latency issue. So another question?
Yeah, but did you choose to do it with the API server? Also two services in different centers?
So we have one master here, one master there.
Yeah.
But what we decided is to have one master, which is the main master, and the backup master in case the whole data center falls down, then it's still doable to work with the other data center. So it's basically a master-slave construction where the one is active and the other one is not active at that point.
Yeah.
And to get back to replication controllers, so basically what we did a lot of usage of labels for secrets, for example. We didn't, when we started, secrets, by the way, are the way to get your credentials, for example, database credentials or any other credentials into the pod, pod, without having it hard-coded somewhere or anything. So basically, Kubernetes obscures your credentials. And we didn't have any fancy features that there is these days with mounting it. We did have mounting it on volume, but there is also a way right now to be able to inject it directly into the environment variables. So we did not have this, so sadly enough, we had to create our own shell scripts that read the data that we have mounted the secret on. So we have mounted the secret on a secret directory. We have to execute a shell script before actually launching the application that goes in that directory, reads all the data and sets it, exposes it to the environment. But these days, then Kubernetes implemented this on its own, so now you can actually inject a secret into the environment directly. What else? Yeah, that's it for now for application controllers. Kubernetes services. So basically, as you all may have heard from previous presentation and you might already know, Kubernetes services is basically one way for you to have different pods. And since the pods are always dynamic, they can break down, they can get spawned on another machine, and every time they spawn, they will probably have a different IP address. And Kubernetes service is basically the way to abstract that whole new IP address mapping thing. So basically you have one entry IP, or in our case we had to have a static file with IPs that we would assign to the Kubernetes service, because at the point when we started we did not have any DNS functionalities. So right now there are DNS functionalities for Kubernetes called SkyDNS. But we did not have this, so we had to create our host file basically and inject it, sadly enough. But so we gave these services, we gave them a static IP, and this static IP then we referenced in different pods. So we injected these static IPs into the pods, and then through Flannel and etcd, then the pods would use that service ID and get routed to any of the instances in the or which was launched. So then you don't have to know every single separate ID, but you just know the service ID, and then you could route in any case if you need to get the data from another service. As you may know, the Kubernetes service also also does automatic load balancing. So and yeah, basically that's it. And if you we had to use also a port exposure, like you mentioned ingress, but back then it was public IPs or something, and we had to use these IP or port port exporting to be able to enter our Kubernetes cluster, because if you come from the outside inward, there is no way to for you to be, know all the different you can know the IPs, the service IPs from the Kubernetes services, you can know them, but as long as you're not in the cluster, it will never be resolved. So we have to expose one service that would function as the entry point into our entire Kubernetes cluster, and basically that service would function as our reverse proxy into our whole environment.
Well, we could configure that at 5.
At 5, those service IPs have a public, like the service IP will get a public IP in our configuration, and those are all the IPs that we host. So if we have 10 machines, we put 10 public IPs in it, and F5 just also knows those 10 IPs, and it will see which one is available, and I route to that. So that's how it works.
Yeah, so basically we didn't have to have one instance of this reverse proxy on each machine, because F5 would then probe that port. If it responds, then it knows, okay, there is someone answering on that, so I can route through this. But you're right, we have two layers of of load balancing, selling, but we could not go around this because the F5 was part of the package. I mentioned volumes. When we started, we did not have these fancy, all the different volume types that Kubernetes offers now. So for example, we had logging that we wanted to accumulate into a certain space, but in the version we started with, the Kubernetes didn't have any network mounting, NFS mounting, so we had to mount a volume of the host machine, and underneath that host machine, then that that directory would be mounted through NFS. So basically, in the end, we took a very, very big loophole and to get to NFS, but it worked, and it can be more efficient, but yeah, we had to do with what we had. Secret and SA Unix, I already discussed. Liveliness probes and readiness probes. I don't know if you guys know anything about how liveliness probes and readiness probes works, but basically Kubernetes has a pod, application service, and it functions just like F5, so a readiness probe is basically querying that service. You can set this to be an HTTP call, you can set it to execute a script every time, and what we did is we used the HTTP variant of this, so basically we had a health check on the service, and this health check would be called every time to see if it's ready to receive incoming requests. So if the service is not available, so we had a Java application with Spring, so that takes half a year to load. And basically, so if the service, the Tomcat instance, isn't ready to receive any incoming HTTP request, then the readiness probe would fail. And then Kubernetes, because Kubernetes, their services, it will not it will not route to a service that is not ready. It will then, let's say, these two are ready and this one isn't, it will only route to those two up until the health check of this service says, okay, I'm ready to receive incoming connections. liveliness probes, on the other hand, is basically, let's say you have a service and it becomes stale. So let's say it it has a database connection that is in a faulty state, or something from anything that happens, and it's also something you have to configure on your own. Let's say our service was down for 5 minutes, or it couldn't reach the database due to some error. What the liveliness probe does is basically you can set a minimum amount of time the health check can fail. So we gave it 4 minutes, basically. So if within 4 minutes the service did not recover itself, Kubernetes would then kill the service and respawn it somewhere else. So this is also one of the functionalities. So basically it would just restart it since it noticed it's not healthy. And this gave us a lot of time, so we didn't have to worry about the services not being available and this kind of stuff, because Kubernetes takes that out of our hands and it does it on its own. And yeah, names and labels we use for all these selectors, and to have an overview of what kind of what services the pods and these things use. So, cool picture. Oh, one thing to note is we chose to run our database outside of Kubernetes because at that point we didn't trust it yet. And yeah, to have your database go down because Kubernetes finds it it's not healthy, it was a little, the risk was way too big. So we decided to host it outside of the Kubernetes cluster on its own machines. And I think most people would tell you to not host it inside a container yet, but to let the container world mature enough to be able to. So this is basically how our services look like internally. So it's basically, this was our reverse proxy. It'll proxy all the calls through Kubernetes services to our actual service implementations. We try to mitigate direct dependencies on services using message queuing. And basically we had Postgres and Cassandra for certain services. We had so we had two different database services. And RabbitMQ and Postgres was outside of, we hosted outside of our Kubernetes cluster. So basically this part and those parts, all the services were all hosted hosted inside of Kubernetes. Last but not least, how did Kubernetes fit into an enterprise organization like IBM? Sadly enough, I have to mention, with a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, we had to fight our way to allow us to innovate. What do you expect? And based on this, we have had a lot of compliance issues. Not issues, but we had to fulfill a lot of compliance, a lot of security checks. But thank God that Red Hat took most of the security risks on their own, so basically we did not have to worry about Kubernetes not being supported or have security holes, because Red Hat as an enterprise solution takes care of this for us. So on that part we had our work cut out for us. We also had to have a lot of security monitoring and being an enterprise organization with financial info of users and all these kinds of things, we're not allowed to host on external hosting parties. So Amazon, Google Cloud, Azure, all these kinds of things were no-go for us because they want to keep their data on-premise and secure and all these kinds of things. So no easy way out. Everything had to have a background and security check. Because yeah, you're in an enterprise organization, and security is the first thing they look at. So no holes, anything. Authorization and role management was very important. So basically, no one was allowed on a machine unless explicitly or unless someone explicitly requests the right. So for example, an ops person is the only one allowed on certain machines. And based on this, it made us as a developer's life very hard to be able to use kubectl commands and this kind of stuff. So because of the strict authorization and role management, we created our custom components. My awesome colleague created some custom components, and we had to have a lot of monitoring. So one of the obfuscated custom components were basically due to the lack of UI within Kubernetes, we created an overview that this is basically the pod overview, and this is a replication controller overview. And what the pod overview does is basically give you a UI view of all of your health checks, what the status is of the pod. It gives you the IPs and all these kinds of things. So if you're interested, and it gave us the option to restart the pod. Let's say a pod is unhealthy or whatever happened, we have the possibility to restart the pod without having to SSH into a machine on production, getting the rights or getting the correct user account to be able to execute any kubectl commands. So this tool obfuscated the whole stack of going into a machine, getting pseudo rights, and allowed us to do a lot of things outside from the outside perspective. And the replication controller part, it basically gave us some kind of possibility to scale up or scale down, because we didn't have automatic scaling, and we wanted to be able to scale machine, scale pods and scale instances outside without having to go onto a machine.
Short hint, 5 minutes.
Yeah, almost done. We have a lot of monitoring, so a lot of numbers, and because our system, we have logs sent on a mounted volume. These logs were then read into an ELK stack, so Elasticsearch and Kibana. And then we could have these kinds of overviews, metrics on response times, and all these kinds of things were possible. And because our system was an event-based system, we were able to retrieve these events, so everything going through message queuing, we were able to export them and create cool graphs of what was possible or whatever happened in the system in real time also.
Okay, so to wrap up, one of our biggest achievements we had in this project was to use Kubernetes and use these tools within ING. So we actually even created our own private pass, because the development environment, actually most environments, are completely scripted. So with a single command, we can create the whole development environment for Kubernetes nodes and test things out. And in the future, perhaps we'll have a vagrant box that can be portable, so a Kubernetes environment that is portable with all the securities and all the settings we have in check. We can transparently deploy to any number of nodes on any number of machines, and it gives us a lot of freedom. We only had 45 minutes, so we were not able to tell you enough about the experience we had with 1 year using Kubernetes. So that's too bad, but if you have any questions about this, or if you want to know anything, you can contact us, or we're still here for a while, so thank you very much. Oh, got one more slide. That's basically what I told already. We can deploy, we can scale, we can lean back. That's a very important thing. If things break down, we don't have to worry about it beforehand. All we have to worry about is, okay, it gets resolved. Now we have to know the cost, so we can immediately grow about that. It doesn't work always. For example, we had one pod that will break our machine by using a lot of disk space and more and more and more until the partition became full, and it broke that node. And what does Kubernetes do? It replaces that pod to a different machine. So step by step by step, it broke our whole cluster. And it happened with multiple things. Not only that, it's very common that happens. And so it's not a bulletproof, silver bullet thing that works everywhere. You have to be careful with clusters as well, even if they recover themselves. We have Docker, so we can use every possible technology which runs on Linux. Our technology stack was way bigger than we just showed you, so that gives us a lot of freedom. We can actually use the right tools for the right job, and that gives us a lot of power and freedom. And one more important thing that we had to figure out, especially in an enterprise application, and that's monitoring. You have more services, that means you need to think more about security. You need to know exactly what's happening, so you need to monitor everything that's happening in your system. And for that, you need a lot of dashboards. And we just showed you two. We've got a lot of monitoring dashboards that trigger or send mails or do things when things are not according to the standard. I think this was the last slide. Yes, thank you very much.
Any questions? Left?
Yeah. Yes? All your application state was residing in the external database?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so that made it easy to scale down, scale up. And what about the database? How did you, I mean, it's, I suppose you had a replicate of the database. So.
Yeah, well, to come up with, we forgot to say one thing. Our logs are not in a separate database. They are running in our Kubernetes cluster, but then they're mounting volumes on their machines. So that's not completely out of the cluster.
But the databases, we didn't have any real performance problems with the databases. We did have one miner, but then we scaled up that database. We scaled up the slave first and then the master, and then we didn't have any real performance issues database-wise. It was just a little fine-tuning on the pool size and all these kinds of things, and that's that was basically the only issue we really had.
And for those databases, in our development environment and in our built environment, we do have them as Docker images. So we started with Docker images, and then for reasons, lots of reasons, we decided to put it in a dedicated machine.
The some are familiar with PCI compliance. Did the use of Kubernetes help help a bit, or was it more of a hindrance due to some kind of distrust on the side of the auditor?
You're working at ING, right?
No.
Someone was working about that. But regarding that, we had to write documents about how secure it was. We had to follow procedures. We had some scans, pen tests, all those kind of tests. And that was all new. So luckily we had people that were doing that for us. I wasn't doing it, thank God, but yeah.
So basically the whole Docker, Kubernetes, anything in the ecosystem is being subjected to the same scrutiny, like for example the concept of VLAN or virtual machines like 15 years, 10 years ago.
Yeah, it's a new technology and it takes enterprises a lot longer to adopt these kind of technologies, but we were basically the first stepping stone to an enterprise organization to go into a certain direction.
Yeah. And right now other projects are going to migrate to Kubernetes as well, because we took the damage.
Yeah, you did the pioneering, and
yeah.
You showed it was able to survive the scrutiny that comes from working for banks, basically.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Did you mention the solution that you use for scripting the environment? Salt, puppets?
I didn't. Mention that in detail. It's with shell. It's with shell scripts and sets and
It could have been a lot prettier, but
it worked.
But is it something that you can easily use to reprovision a new set of machines?
You mean creating machines? Yeah, those are also shells. What we used Atomic Host, Project Atomic. Mm-hmm. It already has Kubernetes and Docker installed. It has a documentation how to configure everything, and we just scripted that configuration according to our needs. That's pretty easy.
Project Atomic has a very rich documentation on how to set up your own small cluster, if you want.
Okay.
Sure. Can you tell us something about if you're running on virtual machines, about the scaling, how many machines, And if you do separate networks for the test environment and so on?
Regarding our own created virtual machines, you mean? How we scale
that? The Atomic, Red Hat Atomic, is it running in a virtual machine or is it running on bare metal?
Red Hat Atomic host is running on a virtual machine. It's running on a virtual machine. On our dev environment, we just spawn three machines with some RAM, some CPU, some data, and then install Atomic on it. It's actually an ISO file, so it's a whole OS. You can see it as installing Ubuntu on a virtual machine.
And for scaling, we don't have automatic scaling on the machine level, but there was we never really actually needed it so far, so we didn't have to scale up from 10 machines to 20 machines at night or something. So that problem we did not have, thank God.
And are the environments separated, the two?
Yeah, the environments are completely separated. You cannot access from one environment to another environment. Yeah.
Last question.
Would you like to work for a bank again, or?
Sure, why not?
If we stay within the innovation track of the bank, yes. If we have to go inside a bank.
We struggled, but it was fun. Let's say that.
Yeah.
Good. Thanks for the talk.